that scripture that says the Lord sits enthroned on the praises of his people. When we praise God, we are ushered into the presence of the King, and we're in his throne room. I hope you guys have had some stuff stirred up in you over this last day and a half here. I hope you don't feel like you have to have all the answers and have overcome all the obstacles in your life, but I hope some things have gotten stirred up in you, and maybe you're thinking about facing some of these defects or some of these addictions, some of these idols that maybe get revealed in something like this. And I know we've talked a lot about what we should do and how we can cooperate with God, but I want to make something very, very clear here. The only way that I get to enjoy the peace that passes all human understanding and continued growth in my walk with God is if I enter into and remain with Him. I have to stay in the presence of God if I have any hope of overcoming the obstacles in my life. You can learn the way to do things. You can bring your willingness. You can change your attitudes. And you can make a decision to surrender all of your stuff to God. But there is only one who has power. And that's Him. And so if you are not with the one who has power, you will forever remain powerless. Has anybody ever heard of a guy named Sky Jatani? You guys need to check this dude out. I think he's going to be huge in Christian circles. He's a Christian author. He's about my age, about 40 years old or so. And he's written a few books, and I listen to him. He's got a little podcast that I listen to. But I got one of his books about 5 or 6 years ago when I was going through all this huge transition in my life. And this book just spoke to me in an enormous way. It's a book entitled With. And in this book, he talks about 5 postures that people who believe in God, 5 postures that people take, that believers in God take with their lives. And he said the first posture is this. He said the first posture is life under God. That there's God up in the sky or wherever God is, and you're just this little, tiny, insignificant thing. And it's this idea of a judgmental and angry God that far too many people for far too long have been taught in Christian churches and in other religions all around the world, that God is over you and you live a life under God. And this leads to so much feelings of insignificance. And this leads to so many people living lives that are hurt. I can't tell you the number of people that I run into outside of the church who are looking for God, and the first part of their story they tell me is how someone in the church, how people, how leaders, how the church itself has hurt them because it was so mean and so judgmental, and that's who they thought God was. So life under God is the first posture that so many people, they just believe that God is some mean, angry guy who's going to judge them. And then there's life over God, which is the most popular form of spirituality in America today, right? God is in his little box and I'm over. God is who I think he is. I come up with my own idea of God, my own conception of God, and that's the one that I talk to and communicate with. And he's the best God. He always agrees with me, right? He thinks the same way I think about. He hates you, I hate you, and so me and God get along just fine. God does whatever I want him to do. One person named this idea moral therapeutic deism. And this is the most popular religion in America. That, you know, God wants to teach us right and wrong, and he's like the great cosmic therapist. He just wants you to be happy. He just wants you to do what makes you feel good and to feel good about your life. And that's all that God is. Life over God. It's not who he's revealed himself to be, but it's who I think he is. The third posture is life from God. And here we treat God like a giant divine vending machine This is what religion produces in people. If I can just learn the right songs to sing, or the right way to dress, or the right time to go to church, or the right things to do during the week, if I can say the right prayers, or just do the right thing, put the money in the plow, I do it all. And therefore, God should bless me. I did what they taught me to do. I practiced my religion, and I pulled the thing, and God's supposed to give me a blessing. Because that's the way that God works. And this is the idea of life from God. And it's a crock. You try to press the little buttons with God and get what you want, and it doesn't work, and it leads to disillusionment and disappointment. The fourth posture that so many people take is called life for God. I don't know if you've ever suffered from this, but you really think, man, I got to do more for God, and I got to go hard for God, and I got to work, and I got to work, and you know, He deserves it, and I'm going to do it for Him. And when I do it for Him, guess what's going to happen? He's going to have to bless me, right? He's gonna kind of owe me one. Anybody ever feel like God kind of owed you one? Nobody's going to raise their hand, but I know it's true. I used to feel like that. I'm a pastor. I've devoted my whole life to telling people about you, Jesus, and this is how you're going to do me. I felt like that. My sister-in-law, probably the funniest example of this that I can think of, she made a deal with God, right? Never make a deal with God, but she made a deal with God. She said, all right, God, I'll give you my virginity if you give me twins. That was her whole thing. So she never slept with him. She had a virgin until the day she was married, and she got pregnant. And she was still, she's married to a Lutheran pastor, and she's still believing that God is going to give her twins because she made this deal with God years ago. She had one baby, and that was it. And she was so crushed because she was living a life for God, thought that somehow, some way, she could manipulate God into doing what she wanted. There is only one model that is found for life in the Bible when it deals with our relationship with God. And it's this posture. And this is what I'm talking about the whole thing tonight. There's one posture that is the biblical posture that Jesus Christ models for us, and it is life with God. This is the whole kit and caboodle of Scripture. Jesus is Emmanuel. What does Emmanuel mean? God with us. God came all the way down because we could not even approach Him. And so He came down to be with us, to make a way for us to get back to life with Him. That's it. If you think that I need to find a relationship with God so I can get what I want, I'm in this whole thing for the blessing, then you're falling into a trap of consumer Christianity. If you tell yourself on Sunday mornings, you know what, I really don't like that song. Maybe I need to go find a church that plays the songs I like. Boy, that pastor can talk and talk. I need to go find a pastor that speaks to me and says all the things that I really don't like that person over there. I'm going to go find a church where I like everybody, or everybody's my age, or they got great programs for my kids or my grandkids, or what they're doing for me, just like we're kicking the tires on a new car, right? I'm going to go find, they better give me a good deal, it better not cost me too much, and it better last forever. And we treat the church like this. We treat God like the attitude of what's in it for me, rather than discovering that the whole purpose of this universe is to live a life with Him. C.S. Lewis says this is what heaven is. Heaven is life with God, and hell is life without God. There might be mansions in hell. You might be rich in hell. You might have beautiful. I don't know what's going to happen in hell. All I know is God's not going to be there. And life without God is devastating on every level because it's the opposite of what we were meant for. We were meant for relationship with Him. And Christ came, God with us, so that we could be with Him. Hanging out with all these drunks, they taught me something about this relationship with God. They said to me that I needed to improve my conscious contact with God, and that I should pray only for the knowledge of His will for me and the power to carry that out. And I heard that, and I said, that doesn't make sense. That's not anything I ever heard, right? I'm supposed to pray for what I want and hope that God gives it to me. I'm supposed to pray for what you want. If I'm a really good Christian, I'll pray blessings for you too. Oh, God, bless them and in all these ways. Give them the desires of their heart. And they said, you know what? The only thing that's important for you, Eric, is to improve your conscious contact with him. To get aware of the fact that he's here. And that he's for you. And that he wants to do life with you. And so just ask him, instead of praying for all the junk that you want, just say, God, what is your will for me? Every day, say, what's your will? And wait for him to reveal it. And then say, give me the strength to do that will. And see what happens. And so I was very much intrigued by this idea. And I thought, well, the drunks are telling me this, and it's not something I heard in church. I wonder if there's any Christian truth to any of this stuff. And so I started doing some research, and the drunks were right. I started finding all kinds of stuff by Christians in history. I found a guy named Brother Lawrence who lived in the 1600s. Anybody ever heard of Brother Lawrence? Brother Lawrence was a little old monk who worked in a kitchen his whole life until he got too old to work in a kitchen, and then guess what he did? He repaired sandals. Until he died. He had no great theological training. He was slaved away in a kitchen, and he died a sandal repairman in this monastery. But every time people would come to this monastery to get away from things or to come and visit or learn something, they'd bump into Brother Lawrence every once in a while. And what they saw was a man who had such an intimate relationship, such a peace filled transcendent relationship with God that they were blown away. And so they would write him letters every once in a while when their life would get too hard and things would get complicated. They say, Brother Lawrence, I know all these other monks, they got all these ideas and stuff, but what are you doing? What's so special about your life? And he would just write to them about how he practiced the presence of God every day, that there was no difference between his prayer life and his work life. In fact, he would get annoyed whenever they would ring the bell and all the monks would have to go and pray because it would interrupt his unstopping communion with God. Everywhere he went, every pan that he scrubbed, every sandal that he fixed was done to the glory of God. And he was aware of his presence all the time. And I thought, man, I wish I had something like that. I wish I could just be aware of God. And I ran into this other book written in the 20th century, which is a little easier for me to understand when people write it in more modern language, by a guy named Frank Laubach, and it was basically the same thing. He had read Brother Lawrence, and he was a teacher, and he went to this place that had never had any Christianity there before. And so he went, and he took it. He was a missionary there, and it was just a collection of a diary entries that he made as he was trying to give Jesus to these people and teach these kids how to read and write. And he was there and he said, I'm going to try to practice the presence of God, just like Brother Lawrence did. And he wrote about what he was doing, and sometimes it was miserable failure, and some days were just so transcendent because he was remembering every moment that God was with him and God was for him. And at the end of this book, he said, you know, here's what you can do, and he gave it a name. He said, I want you to start playing the game with minutes. And the game with minutes is something that's very easy. It's just this. Just for one moment, doesn't have to be a second, but just for one moment of every minute of the day, just remember that God is with me. That's the whole game. One moment of every minute of the day, just try to bring to mind the fact that God is with me. And I'm like, I'm gonna try this. And he was right. At first, you are a miserable failure. Hours will go by and you won't think about God at all. But I started going on long walks with my son and I started to try to play this game with him because it always helps me to have somebody accountable, you know? And so we were playing this game and we just try to remember that God is with us. And somebody would come walking by and we'd say a little prayer for them and we'd bless them, trying to remember that God is with us. And as I got in my car, my car used to be the place where I would serve my idols. I would drink and I would smoke in my car. And instead of serving my idols in my car, I turned it into a place of refuge for me to get away to God. And so I would get into my car and I would just start to pray to him. I'd start to praise him. I'd start to sing these songs and remember that he's with me. Jesus would be sitting next to me in my car everywhere I went. And I'd try to use my imagination. I'd go walking on my walks with a 12-foot-tall Jesus behind me because Jesus is huge, right? and we go walking everywhere. I got a chair in my office that has a sign on it that says, Jesus is here. And people are like, you're weird, Pastor, but I just got to remember, because every time I look over there and I get some stupid idea, I look at the chair because Jesus is right there with me. Anything I could think of to do to remind myself that he's with me. And my life began to change. I began to feel his presence. I began to know that he's got my back, that there's nowhere I'm ever going to be that he's not going to go with me. Psalm 100 verse 4 became my life verse. And it says this, it says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. And I said, I'm just going to do that. I'm not great at doing all these like big, long devotionals. I stink at memorizing scriptures. Pastors who are like, you know, Psalm 34 and, you know, Isaiah 75. And I'm like, I don't even know how many chapters are in the books half the time. I can't remember all of these things. But I could do this. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Because every morning I wake up, I don't know about you, I feel like I'm outside of the city and God is on the inside and we're far away from each other. And it says I can enter into the gates with thanksgiving. And so I wake up every morning and I've trained myself to do this. And I say, God, thank you for this beautiful woman sleeping next to me. And thank you for those two children down the hall. And thank you for my house. And thank you for Southern California. I'm at 72 again today. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I can feel myself coming into his presence, or him coming into me. I don't even know how it works. But I want to get all the way in. And it says you got to enter into his courts where the king reigns. Enter into his courts with praise. And so every morning I get into my truck and I put on some praise music and I just start to sing. Sometimes quietly, sometimes I make a fool of myself. Sometimes I just sit there and let the music wash over me. But with gratitude and praise, I'm ushered into the presence of God. It's the most simple devotional practice I've ever engaged in, and it is one of the most powerful. I stopped wasting my commute. And the truth is, when I first started to do these things of practicing the presence of God, it was easy. I would just think about God, and man, the Holy Spirit was filling me up, and I was just feeling like, everything is possible. God is here. Let's go. And then the days would go by, and lo and behold, things became a little tougher, and I'd have to spend some more time being grateful and praising, and then I'd have to add some other devotional stuff, and I'd have to do some extra work. And then it dawned on me, this is what God's doing to me. He's causing me to mature spiritually. I don't know if you've ever tried to get big. I was pretty big before I got sick, and I've lost a ton of muscle, but I used to be big. And it took a long time for me to get all those muscles. And the bigger I got, the harder it was to get even more muscle. And that's what happens to us spiritually. Sometimes when we're just starting out, man, you can see enormous gains right away, and then it can feel like things are slowing down. But my friends, I encourage you just to chase after God even harder in those times, because he's trying to mature you, trying to grow you up and teach you things that only the mature in Christ will ever understand. And one more thing about this life with God. God gave me a practice that he's been giving to people. He's been commanding people to do for millennia. And I rediscovered it in my own life. I'm a good Lutheran boy, like I said, and I had to learn the Ten Commandments in confirmation class. Everybody learned the Ten Commandments in confirmation class? All right, and I remember that we had to learn the third commandment. What's the third commandment? Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. And then I remembered the meaning, and Martin Luther said that we should fear and love God so that we do not despise preaching and his word, but hold it sacred and gladly hear and learn it. Is that right, pastors? Yeah? Okay, good. And so that's what I thought remembering the Sabbath day was, is we get into God's word and we listen to preaching and we don't complain too much when the pastor talks too long. And that's what the Sabbath day is we go to church and the word and preaching. And then it dawned on me one time. That's not even what Sabbath means. Sabbath means what? Rest. God actually commanded us to take a day off from work. No work whatsoever. So that we could, yes, get into his word, yes, hear some preaching, yes, go to church, but so that we could also just stop and rest and delight. And so God was challenging me through a few different people and a few different sources, and he was saying, I want you to start taking a Sabbath, Eric. I want you to, I mean, you keep the other nine commandments are important to you, but this one you just don't even think about. And he was saying, I want you to rest. And so I talked to my wife, and I said, honey, what do you think about keeping a Sabbath? She's like, what does that mean? I'm like, well, for 24 hours in a row, we cannot do any work at all. We can't clean the house. You can't make me do anything. I can't make you do anything. I can't make the kids do their homework. None of that stuff. We all, as a family, have to just stop and trust that God is going to keep the world running without us for 24 hours every week. And so we planned it all out, and we prepared food ahead of time, and we were starting to get a little excited about it, and we started to keep a Sabbath. And I tell you, my kids took to it like fish to water, because they were just like, nothing, you can't tell us what to do. Yeah, we can do whatever we want. And sometimes they play video games for like 12 hours straight, drives my wife a little bit crazy, but they get to simply do what they delight in, and they get to rest, and so do I, and so does my wife. And now this is a practice that regenerates us, gives us energy to face the rest of the week every week, my friends, because we're trusting that God is on the throne and he's going to make everything okay. All these different practices were designed to do one thing: remind me that he is with me. And if I just remain there, remain with him, things are going to be okay. So I learned all these things, and I was riding high on a pink cloud for like 4.5 years. Man, you could not touch me. It was nonstop spiritual growth. I was slaying demons in every direction I could find in my own life, and I was helping other people to do it. And then the seasons of my life shifted. They changed. And in July 2014, I'd finished preaching that morning, and we had a potluck after church, and I ate some of that food, and I started to get a stomachache. I said, well, I thought, well, you know, it's a church potluck, right? You're going to get a stomachache. So I was feeling a little shifty about who put the bad food out there. And I went home and I took a Pepsi and I took a nap, and I thought, well, this will be fine. And I woke up and I still had a stomachache. It wasn't too bad, but it was there and it was weird. And I slept that night and I woke up and I still had it. And we were supposed to go to Disneyland with the kids that day, because we go to Disneyland all the time. And we were supposed to go. And I said, well, let's just run down to the ER and we'll talk to a doctor. I had diverticulitis the year before, so it's probably something like that, and they'll give me a little pill for it, and then we get on with our day. So I went down to the ER, and nobody was talking to me, but they were all talking to each other after a little while. And then they started issuing all these tests, and I was going in for CAT scans and all kinds of weird stuff. And they checked me in, and they didn't let me out for a couple of weeks. And they went in, and they said, you got stage 4 colon cancer. And it's metastasized to your liver. And you have, the medical term was, you have innumerable lesions in your tumor, or in your liver. I was like, well, what does that mean? And they said, well, and they look at you with that crazy face. And they said, I'm sorry, but you have a 5% chance of living for 5 years. You have about a 50% chance of making it to 3. We're really sorry. And I was devastated. 41 years old. I got a 13-year-old kid and an 11-year-old kid. My wife's in her mid-30s. And I take care of them. That's what I do. And now I got 3 years to live. I immediately forgot everything that I had learned in the previous 4.5 years about trusting God. Because I got a good forgetter. I don't know about you. But if I don't habitually do things, if I don't read and reread, if I don't hear and then listen again and again to the same stuff, I forget very, very quickly. And I forgot everything I had learned about trusting God. This is why I need habits in my life. I don't know if you've ever had cancer. I know some of you have. And you can testify to this. When you get cancer, everybody in the world who's ever known somebody who's ever had cancer will come and tell you exactly what you need to do next. And they got all kinds of advice, and some of it is wacky, and some of it is just strange. Some of it's probably good. I don't know. I kind of started to tune people out after a while because they were telling me, Pastor, you got to do this. You got to do this. You got to try this diet. You can't ever eat this food again. Some guy gave me some, you know, cancer therapy through music healing or something like that, and I just threw that book in the trash. But all kinds of stuff started coming at me. And then the doctors would tell you, well, you could do this. But if you do this, then later on you can't do this. And this has some hope for some people. And so I was sitting there. They had taken half of my colon out. And they gotten rid of the big tumor that started the whole thing. And I was sitting there in the hospital, and all this stuff was going on around me. And I was trying to figure out, what am I going to do? You could go this way or you could go this way. I have no idea. I've never been prepared. I didn't even know what stage 4 cancer meant. Stage 4 is like, that's the worst cancer you can get. I had no idea that that's what it was until I got it. And so I was terrified. And I was crippled by fear. And I didn't know what to do. And so I was praying. And God spoke to me. And he said, Eric, you can either trust me or you can trust you. And that's all he said to me. But He'd been so good to me before. He'd been so amazing to me, pulling me out of the pits that I had dug for myself. He had been so good to me for so long that I dared to believe that I could still trust him. And so I did. And I said, God, reveal to me why there's so much fear here. Why don't you just show me? Has anybody ever seen The Soul Survivor? They got these little things called hidden immunity idols, right? They're like hidden away, and if you find one, then you got your little idol. And God revealed to me that I had a hidden idol in my life. I thought I had surrendered everything. I looked at all my character defects, and I offered them over, and the alcohol was long gone. But he showed me that I had a hidden idol, and it was this. I thought that I had to stick around to provide for my wife and my kids. Because that's what a man does. And that was being taken away from me. And it was devastating. I wasn't going to be there to provide. I wasn't going to see my children graduate from high school. I wasn't going to give them away, you know, my daughter away at her wedding. I wasn't going to be able to teach my son all about being a man. And I had to surrender my wife and my precious babies to God and say, you're going to have to be big enough to take care of them when I can. And that was the hardest act of surrender I have ever had to undergo. But as soon as I did it, some of that peace started to come back into my life. And as I kept doing it every morning, every afternoon, all day long, as I was practicing his presence, and we were talking about all this stuff all the time, I kept saying, God, you've got him, right? You've got him. You got to promise me that you've got him. And I was able to surrender that, and he was giving me peace, and I was starting to carry this peace with me through this horrible ordeal that I'm still kind of walking through. He's given me this peace, and I get to carry it with me because I trust in the Lord. You see, he's been a good friend to me. I know Jesus. I used to know all about Jesus. I went to seminary for 4 years, and they teach you all about Jesus. You read all kinds of books. You get all this information. I read the Bible cover to cover, and I had all the facts about Jesus, but I didn't really know him. The word is yada in Hebrew. And it's the word, when it says in Genesis that Adam knew Eve, that's that word. And I began to know Jesus. Not to weird it all out or anything, but I began to have this intimate experience of God in me and me with God, remaining in him, abiding in him. And he became my friend. And we had walked through all these different things together. And now he had brought me to this place, battling for my life and surrendering my family. And I knew I could trust him. I could still trust him because he was my friend. John 15:14 says this, "You are my friends if you do what I command you." That doesn't mean that if you disobey God, he's not going to be your friend anymore. What that means is that through the act of obedience that we talked about earlier, through those different acts of obedience, we start to trust God more because we see that he was telling us the truth the whole time. He said the universe works like this. You hate your enemies, but guess what? Life would be much more beautiful for you if you loved your enemies and if you prayed for them. You're holding on to these resentments and it's poisoning your soul. Your life would be far more beautiful if you just forgave everybody outright the way that I forgave you. He says, I dare you to experiment with these things. If you're my friend, just obey me and see how good of a friend I really am to you. And so I kept on obeying him. I didn't know what the right thing was. I didn't know what the next thing was to do. So I just kept doing those wonderful habits that I had put into my life. And I began to do something else with this word trust. Do you know that faith and trust in Scripture mean the same thing? And so I started, every time I would read the Bible and I'd come across this word faith, I would just replace it with trust. Because faith kind of has all these kind of like religious-y things going with it. But trust is something I can know. That I'm willing to just put myself in the hands of somebody else. And so every time I ran across faith, I would just substitute trust. Things like this. It is by grace we have been saved through trust. Not just believing intellectually in Jesus, but trusting him with your life and the things of your life. And so I just kept on obeying him. And my trust kept on going. I practiced all these habits. I didn't know what to do, so I just kept on doing the habits. And for a month, I was on all this junk. I was on something called oxaloplatin. It's like platinum-based. It's like getting mercury poisoning all over your body. And I couldn't feel my hands and my feet. And when I could feel them, it was terrible pain. My penis quit working. Yeah, that's some messed up stuff right there. I had nerve pains in my penis. I don't say that in church, but I'll say it to you guys. Some messed up stuff. And all this stuff was accumulating, and there were other drugs that were putting in me, and steroids, all kinds of stuff. And for a month, last February, I flat out lost my mind. I went insane. I had no emotional control. Somebody would say something to me, I would just fly off the handle. I'd start crying at the drop of a hat. I had no ability to control what I was thinking or what I was feeling. But God went with me, even into the depths of that insanity. He went with me to those places, and I just kept on doing these habitual things, waking up every morning, saying I'm grateful for all these things, praising God on my way to a meeting that I had to go to every day, and I would still serve other people, and I would still try to be useful. And my friends, it is hard to be useful when you've got cancer. Not because you don't want to be useful, not because you can't do things, but because people are always like, well, I didn't want to bother you. I know you're going through all this stuff, so I didn't want to ask you for anything. I didn't want to tell you about what was going on in our marriage, and we got divorced. Sorry about that, Pastor. But we didn't want to trouble you with those things. My friends, if I ever learned anything, it was this. The best way for me to get out of my own junk is to start thinking about other people. Because the most worthless, useless human emotion that will ever be discovered is self-pity. Amen? Amen? You might have a great reason for it. I got the best reason I've ever had in my life through no fault of my own. I got this terrible cancer that's trying to ravage my body. Not my fault. But feeling sorry for myself will accomplish absolutely nothing, but it will keep me stuck in a place I do not want to be. And that's all that self-pity ever does for you. I don't care if people have hurt you. I don't care if it was all her fault or all their fault. If you're wallowing in self-pity, even if you think you have a right, even if you do have a right to it, I urge you, give it up and start thinking about other people and how you can be useful. So, this past year, I have learned an enormous amount about suffering because I've had to endure so much suffering. I'm sure, guys, most of what you hear about in church is all this uplifting, God can do all these things, right? You're tired of hearing about suffering, but in just a few more minutes here. You see, back 5 years ago when all this stuff started rocking and rolling in my life, I went on this Holy Spirit journey. I said, you know, I wonder what else God can do that I missed. Because I missed a whole lot of things when I went to seminary and when I was sitting in church. And I said, what else is God up to? And so I said, you know, the Holy Spirit, I want to learn more about him. And I wasn't going to go talk to Lutherans because we believe in the Holy Spirit, right? We just don't know exactly what he does, right? So I went and I found some Pentecostal friends, and they seemed to really understand what the Holy Spirit was up to. So I'm like, can you guys teach me what you think the Holy Spirit does? And so I started doing all these things and following all these people, and we were praying for miracles and laying hands on people and praying for healings, and we were asking God to show us people and going out and feeding homeless people, and it was amazing all the things that I was learning about what the Holy Spirit is still up to and what the Holy Spirit is still able to do. But I also learned about a weakness in the minds of some people who are following the Holy Spirit. They rely too heavily sometimes on physical miracles. They rely too heavily on the fact that, well, Jesus has to heal you. And if you got enough faith, he will heal you. And if you're not getting healed, it's because you didn't have enough faith. And this is a devastating thing that can happen in some circles. You see, when I was laying there in my hospital bed and I just cut in half my colon out and I didn't know if I was going to live or die, I had one of my Pentecostal pastor friends come in and he said, Eric, you need to stop calling yourself an alcoholic or God will not heal you. I said, get out. All I know is that his power is made perfect in my weakness. And that somehow, as weak as all this is, his power is going to be revealed. He's still up to something in my life. I don't see it. I don't know what it is. But I know that he can be glorified even in my suffering. And I became a devotee of C.S. Lewis because I was just looking for anybody who was writing about suffering. Everybody wants to write about victory and power and overcoming. But C.S. Lewis had some great stuff to say about suffering. He said this in a book called The Problem of Pain. He said, when pain is to be born, a little courage helps more than much knowledge. A little human sympathy more than much courage. And the least tincture of the love of God more than all. And he was reminding me, in the midst of all the stuff that's going on, and the worst things that I can face, I need just to be with God more than ever. That is the balm that is going to soothe every problem that I face, every problem that any of us can face, is just being with him. Not that we're not going to walk through horrific things, not that terrible things aren't going to befall us, but we have a promise. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. You will never have to fight any monster or darkness in your life without God by your side. All we need is to be with him. So I've been walking this whole year, trying to stay close to God, practicing his presence. And sometimes it's been a desert. Sometimes I've gotten into fear. But this whole year has been a challenge, and it's been leading up to some things. And for 13 months, I was dying. They told me I had maybe 3 years to live. And they put me on this chemo, which makes you feel like you're dying. So as you're dying, you actually feel like you're dying. And it's a terrible thing. But there was one ray of hope. There was this surgery that we were trying to get to. And even though I didn't qualify for it because I had innumerable lesions on my liver, and they said, if you have more than two, you don't qualify for this surgery. But I found some surgeon who was crazy enough to say, look, I'd be happy to cut you open. And I'm like, all right, I'm going to talk to this guy here. And he said he would do it. And so 3 months ago, we scheduled a surgery. Or we scheduled a surgery 3 months ago. And then our insurance company said, you know what? We don't like this guy. And we want you to talk to our surgeons over here. And we went and talked to those surgeons, and they said, I'm sorry, you're not a very good candidate. And so the insurance company said, no more surgery for you. And the other doctors were like, well, we can do some stuff, and it might, you know, give you an extra year. How does that sound? It's like, well, it sounds like crap, right? I want the surgeon. I want a shot at healing, please. And they were like, no. And so 9 months into all of this, with chemotherapy and surgery and my thing, and for stage 4 cancer, I dropped my insurance company. And I moved without insurance for a month, which is a terrifying feeling if you've got stage 4 cancer not to have health insurance. But my wife was, she's an amazing woman. She was on the phone for like 9 hours a day, 5 days a week, just talking to insurance people, trying to find a carrier who would cover this particular doctor that we wanted, and then fighting with them to let us in, even though I had stage 4 cancer. And she was going through all these things, and we were trying to get into this surgery. And it was only like, you know, a month to go, and if we missed this cutoff, it was going to put everything out of touch for us. And so on like the day before it was the cutoff date, she got somebody to say yes. And so then we scheduled the surgery, and we got the surgeon that we wanted. And a couple days after that, we got an insurance card in the mail. And I want somebody else to read this because you're going to think I'm lying. But we finally got this insurance card from this insurance carrier who said yes to us. And I want you to read the contract code down here at the bottom.
Oh, geez. One God.
The contract code on my insurance is 1G0D. I believe in signs, and I believe in wonders. And God was giving us a sign that he's not through with us, not by a long shot. I finally brought it back to the theme, Aaron, right? That God's not done with me, not by a long shot. My odds after this surgery, and it was successful. He went in, he took 70% of my liver out 3 months ago, and he went in and he zapped all the other tumors he could find. And the last test I had just about a month and a half ago said, you're clear. Not a tumor there. Praise the Lord. Now, the doctor doesn't expect it to stay that way, but the doctors didn't expect me to go from a 5% chance of living for 5 years to an over 60% chance of living for 5 years. It was an amazing thing for us. And something really weird happened. You see, I had spent the whole year getting ready to die, giving up all of these things and saying, yeah, this is it. You know, my career is going to be over. My life's going to be over. And I just made all these plans. I refinanced my house. We got all this living trust. You can get out of student loan debt if you're dying. And that's the only way. Bankruptcy won't let you out. But if you got a terminal disease, they will cancel your student debt. So I got my student debt canceled. It was beautiful. Of course, you got to be dying in order to get this thing. But, you know, I did it. I made all these plans to die. And now all of a sudden, it's like, you might live for, you know, 10, 15, 20 years. And so I had to start thinking again, what am I going to do next? And so at the end of my recovery period, and I was on disability for a little bit, and I was getting ready to come back, I came out to Texas, up to Dallas. I got some good buddies up there, and I just wanted to see everybody after all this stuff. And I got back, and the day I got back home, Aaron called me, and he asked me to come out here and do this. And I can't tell you what a blessing this has been to me. This has been kind of the kickstarter in me coming back to life. You know? And I'm so grateful. And a week after I got this call from Aaron, I got a call from a church up in Illinois. And they had sent me a packet like the week after I got done with surgery, and this was church. They were looking for a senior pastor. And I'm like, oh, whatever. And I threw it in the junk pile. And then they called me, and they said, hey, we'd really like to schedule a meeting with you. And I have learned a lot in these last few years, and I never say no to God. And if a church wants to talk to me, I'm at least going to talk to them, right? And so I get on the horn with this call committee at this church, and I lead with brokenness, right? Like I'm telling you, I said, you know what? I'm an alcoholic. I got stage 4 cancer. Praise the Lord. You know, things are looking a little bit better for me now. But, yeah, hey, I don't know. I'm probably going to die, you know, in 10, 15, 20 years. But You know, I'm excited about what God has for me now. I'm not going to waste what's left of my one and only life. And then we hung up the phone after we talked a little while. And I went to my wife and I said, we'll never hear from those people again. 2 days later, they called me back. And they said, we'd love to fly you and your wife up here to Decatur, Illinois, and interview you. We're going to interview like four pastors and their wives. And so 2 weeks ago, they flew us up there to Decatur, Illinois, and they interviewed us. And it was, you know, we had a great time. And then we went back home, and they're looking at these other four pastors now. Who are they going to call? And so I'm thinking, you know what, that was, I feel so alive now. You know, I'm going to go talk to these men in Texas. And how cool is it that this, and this is a big church. They like worship like 900 people. And the biggest church I've ever been at, it worships like 150 people. And I'm so content. I love my small church ministry and the health and all the stuff that's going on where I'm at in San Diego. Love it. And this big giant church is looking at me and I'm like, man, what an honor just to be considered. You know, by a place like that. You know, little guy like me, I don't know anybody, and I've been dying for a year, so how cool is that? They'll come to their senses, though, right? Because you're not going to call a guy who's an alcoholic with stage 4 cancer to come and be your senior pastor. And 3 days ago, I got a call from the head of the call committee. And he's like, it's unanimous. The call committee and the board of elders is going to put your name up in front of the congregation on October 25th, and we're going to call you to be our senior pastor. And I said, man, we got a lot of praying to do, don't we? We got a lot of things to think about here. And I want to ask all of you to please pray for me. And I was like, thank you, God, I get to go to Texas for a few days here. Because you and I need to talk about some things. Because I can't even wrap my mind around the idea that God still has an open door for me. He's still got plans for me. That he's not done with me. That he's opening up bigger doors than I ever imagined. Because I didn't seek any of this. But he just started opening things. And I was as honest as I could possibly be. And these people were crazy enough to issue me a call. And that kind of turns me on. Because, you know, I mean, they're moving in faith, you know. It's going to take a miracle for this idea to work out. It would take a miracle for me to live long enough to do anything good. But I'm thinking about it. I'm praying about it. And if God's in this, I'm going. Because I will not miss a movement of God in my life. I will not do it. I have missed far too many, and he's been far too good to me, and he's shown himself to be able to accomplish the impossible in my life as long as I'm with him. Amen? So don't tell anybody in my church yet, because they don't know. But I pray that you guys know that God is not through with you, not by a long shot. Whatever you got going on, however at the bottom you might feel, however tired and spent you might feel, God is not through with you by a long shot. So even if it's hard, and even if it sounds crazy, and even if it costs you more than you think you are ready to pay, if God is inviting you into something, if he just wants to overcome some obstacle in your life, I want you to let him do it. I hope you let him do it. If he wants to call you into some other way of living, some other life, maybe some other job, I hope you say yes if you get the sense that this is from God, no matter what it costs, no matter how crazy it might be. Because my friends, I know one thing, that with God, all things are possible. But only if you're with God. Amen.